changing cast of characters. So I'm going to start tonight and ask everyone to just introduce themselves and tell you sort of who they are and where they work in Westwood Public Libraries.
My name is Claire Bonds. I work at the Branch and I work here Monday night. I live in Westwood and I work for the library for 13 years.
I'm Jenny Durant, and I also work at the Branch Library with Claire. I am one 10-page paper and one interview away from getting my master's degree in library science. And I've worked here for 5 years.
I'm Christy Pasquarello. I'm a children's librarian. I've worked here for about 5 months. So I'm the newest employee.
Oh, I'm Susan White. I work in circulation, and I've been here 16 years.
So, well, thanks everybody for coming. We're going to start with Claire, who it's totally alphabetical. So the way we decided it would work is each person will go through their 4 books all at once. And then, one at a time all at once. So, okay.
Which works for me because I get all over. I'm sorry. That's not last name. No, it's Connor. It's the last name. So my first book is Celestine's Little Fires Everywhere, which is it's about two families, and one is perfect. You know, everything's perfect. 4 kids. Perfect wife, perfect husband, perfect family, good job. And then the other family is single mother with a daughter, moves to town. The first family rents a house to the second, and there's a lot of fires that need to be put out in this story. It's an interesting story. I read her other book and I really liked that. Lies I Never Told You. That was her first book, this is her second. And I looked up to see what other authors that were similar to her, and it told me Anna Quinlan, Alternate Side, and Leanne Moriarty's Big Little Lies. I have never read Anna Quinlan's book. I don't know. Big Little Lies, though. It's a good book. It's not out yet. It's J.P. Delaney's Believe Me. The character's name is Claire, and she is from Britain. She's an actress, and she does, she's not legally here. So she's hired by a law firm to kind of set up married men that meet women in bars, and it mostly is. And one of the men's wife gets killed. So it's kind of a psychological thriller, which is my favorite. So authors like her are Ruth Ware and Claire McIntosh. I don't know if anyone likes either of those, but this isn't out yet. I'm not sure when it is coming out, but that's another really good one. Elizabeth Berg is coming to Westwood on August 6th. I was told it. August 6th at 7 p.m. She'll be coming. The story of Arthur Cooper. Arthur is a widow and goes to the cemetery every day to have his lunch. His wife's great. And he meets a young girl who's bullied at school, kind of goes to the cemetery to get away from the kids at school. And they form a friendship. And then there's another third person in the group that's a kind of nosy neighbor. And the three of them form a relationship. It's really a good story. Has anyone read this? Have you read it? You smile like you read it.
No, that's good.
That's good. I really, Patron actually recommended it to me, and I really like that. And if you like her books, Gabriel Zevin and Frederick Bachman came up as similar books to Elizabeth Burns. And my last book is Only Child by, Rhiannon Nabel. And it's a school shooting told in the voice of a 6-year-old, a kindergartner, who's in the closet in the classroom when the school shooting starts. It's a tough read, but I thought it was very well written. And she brings in like children's books. He he liked the Magic Treehouse, so she brings in a whole series of Magic Treehouse books into the story. And online, if you like this book, they said Joan Picoult, she had written a book about the school shooting in the teens, but this was probably one of my favorites. Really well, it's her first book and it was really well written.
Thank you.
Okay, so the first book that I want to talk about is called The Line Becomes a River. It's a nonfiction book by Francisco Cantu. And so no matter your feelings on immigration, it would be hard not to be affected by this book. He's written an account of what it was like for him to be a Border Patrol agent. He was a Border Patrol agent from 2008 to 2012. And it was published earlier this year before this latest level of parents being separated from children began. And from Goodreads it says, as a Border Patrol agent, Cantu and his partners were posted to remote regions crisscrossed by drug routes and smuggling corridors, where they learned to track other humans under blistering sun and through flames. They hauled in the dead and delivered to detention those they found alive. Cantu tried not to think where the stories went from there. Plagued by nightmares, he abandoned the patrol for civilian life. So that's kind of in the middle of the book, and then the last section of the book talks about a friend he has who is an immigrant, and Jose, who he gets to know because he's gone to work in a coffee shop, he's gone back to graduate school, he wants to become a writer. And Jose has a wife and three kids, and they don't really discuss his status, but he finds out that he's here illegally, and Jose decides to go back to Mexico to see his mother who's dying. And at the end of the book, you find out what happens to Jose when he tries to come back into the country. And it's a true story. It's a little hard to read. It's sad. But it's really timely. I think it's definitely worth getting to know what's going on. So I think I thought it was a great book. The second book that I have is Manhattan Beach by Jennifer Egan. And this is a good read. Patty Wake, who I was talking to today, said this book is like the Mafia meets World War II meets women's empowerment. So it kind of covers a lot of topics. It's set in World War II. The main character in the book, Anna Carrigan, was abandoned by her father when she was 12, and now she's working in the Brooklyn Naval Yard, and she becomes the first female diver, and she's helping repair ships that will help America win the war. So, it's her story, and there's a lot of interwoven stories here about her and her relationship with her father, and with a character we learn, Dexter Stiles, who's a mafioso, and we find out what he had to do with her father's leaving. It's a good read. It's pretty fast-paced. It's a good, it's not exactly lighthearted, but not too tough.
Good
Beach Read, yeah. It won the 2018 Andrew Carnegie Medal for Excellence in Fiction, so good. And then the last two books I have, I wanted to talk about because they were movies that were coming out last month. Now, I don't know, even know how either one of them actually did, and I have to admit that I didn't see either of them. But the one I was gonna talk about first is A Wrinkle in Time by Madeleine L'Engle. And this is a science fiction book. It was written, or published in 1962, and it won the Newbery Medal in 1963. And it's what's cool about it is that in 1962, having a strong central female character was a little more unusual. And so it's about a girl named Meg who's a troublesome teenager having problems at school. Her teachers tell her that they don't know how she can be such a poor student when both of her parents are scientists. And Meg finds out, her father has disappeared. It's been over a year. She doesn't know what's happened to him. The family doesn't know. But she finds out with the arrival of a mysterious Mrs. What's-It one stormy night that her father has invented a tesseract that she learns is a time-traveling machine. And she and her brother Charles Wallace and a boy from school, Calvin, get to go in this tesseract and try to rescue her father from pure evil. So it's a great story. And there was a review on Goodreads that I wanted to read because this guy, his name's Dave Courtney, I have no who he is, but I liked what he had to say about it. He said, "There is a rather profound and timely commentary in this story about the ways in which we see ourselves, the ways in which we accept others, and the socio-political forces that push back against our responsibility towards each other. I was able to see this through fresh eyes, and it had me hooked. Loved it every bit as much as I did when I was young, and appreciated it maybe even more, considering how much more I am aware of the state of the world. I needed this message of this book, one in which love wins over hate." So, it's a great story. Classic. And then, last but not least, my new favorite book, Ready Player One. And this is by Ernest Cline. It was published in 2011. And I just read it this spring because I had an assignment for a young adult book. I was reading young adult books about virtual reality. And this book, if you're a child of the 80s, which I am, like every possible 80s reference is in this book. And it's really funny and you'll enjoy that. The story is about Wade Watts, and it's in the year 2044, and he's taking refuge from the harsh reality of his life, living as an orphan in these stacked trailers called the Stacks, and they're set up like that because the oil crisis has happened and global warming is taken over, and so there's lots of poverty, and it's a hard life. And so he's created this little hideout where he goes to attend online school, he plays video games, and uses his online avatar, Parzival, to virtually visit his only friend, H. And things get serious when the creator of the Oasis, this virtual reality, James Halliday, dies and has created a quest for whoever can solve his puzzle will inherit all of his money and the Oasis. Wade is instantly obsessed. Will he win the quest? Will he even survive? You have to read it to find out. And I actually listened to the audio version of this, which was read by Will Wheaton. And if you watch The Big Bang Theory or if you ever watch Star Trek, he was a character in there. And Will Wheaton is mentioned in this book as a character from Star Trek. So that was perfect. It's great. It's a lot of fun. And it made the list of the Great American Read for PBS this summer, which, if you don't know, is they have 100 books that you can vote on, and there's a show, is it every week?
Yeah.
The summer, oh, so you can vote. So, it's a good one.
All right, so I'm a children's librarian, but I only have one children's book to talk to you about tonight, and those are adult books. So I thought I would actually start by reading the first page and a half of this, prologue, because I think it sort of sets it up and then you get an idea of her writing, which is just really gorgeous. And I actually book talked this to all of the children of Westwood for summer outreach book talks, and I hooked a lot of kids with the first page and a half, so we hook you too. So this is Beyond the Bright Sea, and it's by Lauren Wolk. My name is Crow. When I was a baby, someone tucked me into an old boat and pushed me out to sea. I washed up on a tiny island like a seed riding the tide. It was Osh who found me and took me in, who taught me how to put down roots and thrive on both sun and rain and understand what it is to bloom. The island where we found each other was small but strong, anchored by a great pile of black rock that sheltered our cottage, a ramshackle place built from bits of lost ships, nestled on a bed of earth and sea muck alongside a small garden and a skiff that took us wherever our feet could not. We didn't need anything else. Not in the beginning. At low tide, we could cross easily to the next island, Cuttyhunk, through shallow strewn bootlace weed and minnows. At high tide, the cottage sat so close to the risen sea that it felt nearly like a boat itself. For a long time, I was happiest when the water rose and set us apart on our own, so just the two of us decided everything there was to decide. And then one night when I was 12, I saw a fire burning on Penicacy, the island where no one ever went, and I decided on my own to find out where I'd come from and why I'd been sent away. But I didn't understand what I was risking until I nearly lost it. So that's the prologue. So this is about a girl named Crow, and as she says, when she's a baby, she washes up in a boat, and she's rescued by this fisherman named Osh, and he raises her as his own. And when she sees the fire burning on Penicacy, used to be a leper colony, and no one has lived there. It's been abandoned for many years. And Osh thinks that that's the only place that she could have come from and survived the boat trip.
So a lot of the people in the closest town also think that she came from Pennington City and they don't treat her very well. They treat her as if she still could have the disease. They're terrified of her. And so she's always sort of lived with that. And then she sees this fire burning in Pennington City and she decides that she wants to go over there and investigate and see if she can find any clues about her past. So she convinces Osh to take her there, which in itself is kind of risky because no one else will set foot on this island. So it's a really, it's intended for middle grade, it's a middle grade novel, but it's, I think it's the perfect crossover novel. It's beautifully written, as you maybe could tell from the prologue, and the author just does this really great job sort of balancing Crow's emotions, she's really hopeful and excited, and then Osh, the fisherman, who is really worried that her heart's going to be broken if she doesn't find out the information that she wants, and he's also nervous about losing her. It's just a beautiful story. Probably one of my favorite books I read last year, and if you're an audiobook person, it's really good on audio. So if you need something to listen to on a road trip, it's a really good audiobook. So that's Beyond the Bright Sea. And for something completely, completely different, this is Social Creature. It's by Tara Isabella Burton. So this is a thriller. It's been called A Talented Mr. Ripley for the Digital Age, which I think pretty accurate, and it's also been described as Gone Girl meets Gossip Girl, which is also a really good description. So the story is about two women, Louise and Lavinia. Louise moved to New York to become a writer. She's having trouble breaking through. The reality is that she works three jobs. She lives in the outskirts of Brooklyn, in the place where the uncool part of Brooklyn. She takes two buses, two subways, just to get to work in Manhattan every day, and she can barely pay bills. But then she meets Lavinia, a rich, beautiful, eccentric, and self-obsessed young woman who basically just lives in search of her next thrill and the chance to post something amazing on Instagram. So they meet when Lavinia hires Louise to tutor her sister, and they just hit it off right away. And the main reason they hit it off is because Lavinia is the type of person who just hardly notices other people. She just sort of projects onto them, and she takes Louise's on as like an accessory. She dresses her in her old designer clothes, and she just drags her along to all of the parties and the social events that they go to all the time. And it's very glamorous, high society in New York. They go to like Shakespearean masked balls and like secret parties in brownstones, and they have a box at the opera. And everybody that they meet is like has a story in the New Yorker. Is like, so Louise is hoping to sort of make a connection. And they're always sort of drinking champagne and going to the park, living that sort of like modern Gatsby lifestyle and making plans. But this is a thriller, and it's a thriller about obsessive friendship. So before the book is over, Lavinia is dead. And she tells me that like on the third page. So don't worry, I didn't just write it for you. Trust me, it's like page three. So the story, this friendship is obsessive, it sort of spirals out of control. And so because you find out immediately that one of the Vinny's gonna die, it becomes how and what happens. And if you know anything about The Talented Mr. Ripley, then you might have an idea. So, yes, this was really fun. Definitely take this to the beach with you or if you're, or just on Saturday on your deck, which is what I did. This is My Salinger Year by Joanna Rakoff. So Joanna Rakoff is a writer. She has a novel called The Fortunate Age. She's mostly a journalist. I think she writes for The New Yorker and The New York Times. And this is her memoir of a year she spent living in New York City when she was first starting out. She moved to New York City in the 1990s, basically just before everything went digital and went online. She finished a graduate program and was hoping to become a poet. So a lot like Louise in Social Creature. She moves to New York to try to make it. I really like New York stories, you might. Coming of age New York stories, I love those. So she moves to New York in the 90s, and she gets a job as an assistant to the famous literary agent for J.D. Salinger, who authored Catcher in the Rye and Nine Stories, and a famous recluse. So this literary agency is stubbornly old-fashioned. It's like wood panel that's lined with like plush furniture. It looks like Mad Men. She describes it like stuff in the 1960s, but very luxurious. And they have no computers. They're even in the early 1990s,
these people do have computers. They refuse to have computers. They have dictaphones, and they have typewriters. And so she's hired as an assistant to this literary agent, and her job, incredibly, is to answer J.D. Salinger's fan mail. And so, as you can imagine, she's reading like the most heartfelt, amazing personal letters about what his work has meant to people. And she is supposed to respond with this form letter that was written in the 1960s, like 30 years before. I'll read you what the form letter is supposed to say. Dear Miss So-and-so, many thanks for your recent letter to J.D. Salinger, but as you may know, Mr. Salinger does not wish to receive mail from his readers. Thus, we cannot pass your kind note on to him. We thank you for your interest in Mr. Salinger's books. Best at agency. So she's reading, I mean, her job is to sit and read these letters all day long, and they're amazing stories of like shell-shocked soldiers who feel like nobody understands them except J.D. Salinger. And she decides that she can't send form letters back to all of them, so she starts writing them back in letters. And she's not really supervised very much, as you might imagine. So she gets away with it. And then in the background is just her trying to make it in New York City, and her life and what's going on as like a young person in she's like in her 20s, trying to make it as a poet. So it's a lovely, she's a beautiful writer. When poets write memoirs, their every sentence is like gorgeous, so it's really lovely. And I also read this in a day. It doesn't sound like it's like a fast read, but I read this in a day because it's just really, you get lost in it. So that's my Salinger. And then last is the Knicks. And I was nervous about doing this one because it's such a huge book to describe. I mean, it's like huge, and there's a lot in this book. So this is the Knicks by Nathan Hill. This was Nathan Hill's first novel. And it's one of those novels that's just super hard to describe because it's this sweeping epic and there's so much in here. So let me tell you what it's about and then I'll try to describe why I like it so much. So when Samuel was a kid, his mother told him the Norwegian folktale about the Nyx, which was a kind of water spirit that tricked children into trusting it and then stole them away. So his mother told him the story, and she told him that the moral of the story is that the things you love the most would one day hurt you the most. And so this proves true for Samuel because he's one of these kids who hangs on his mother's every word, he's obsessed with her, and then she abandons the family when he's 11. So fast forward years later, it's year 2011. Samuel's a failed writer. He's working at this sort of third-rate college in the Midwest, teaching English to completely uninterested students. his life is kind of in shambles. He has no friends. He's sort of isolated from everybody. He spends a lot of time online. And he's just in sort of a terrible place. And then he gets this phone call from a man claiming to be a lawyer who's representing his mother for her assault charges. He's confused because he hasn't seen his mother in 20 years. He hasn't heard, seen from her, or anything. And the man explains that his mother is now the star of this viral video on the internet because she attacked the senator of Wyoming, the governor of Wyoming. She ran into him. She was in a park where he was doing an event, and she picked up rocks and just threw them in, screaming obscenities. And someone caught it on video, and in the way of the world now, somebody filmed it. It's become a viral video sensation. Millions of people have viewed it. It's on Fox News. People are writing editorials about this woman. And to give you a little background, the governor of Wyoming is kind of like a Bill O'Reilly crossed with Donald Trump. Just to give you an idea, he's super right wing, he says crazy things, and like half the country loses their mind, and the other half of the country goes crazy because they love him. So he's like this divisive guy who's a real character. And he's kind of like, I want to say he's like a satire, but in the world that he's maybe not based on the way things are going. But so anyway, that's where she attacks. And so she's now in big trouble. She's facing serious charges for assaulting the senator. And she's famous. And the media is portraying her, they've looked at her in the past and they're saying that she's this former 60s radical and that she has this whole past life as this radical activist and that she was present during the Democratic National Convention in 1968 in Chicago. And Samuel watches the video and sees that it is his mother, but has no idea about this past, like the mom that he knew was this sort of mild-mannered housewife who grew up in Iowa and married her high school sweetheart, his dad, and then mysteriously left the family, but he didn't know anything else about her life. So he he's confused, but he decides that he'll help her because the lawyer is saying like she needs help. She's in a tough situation. So this sort of sets the groundwork for him to investigate his mother's life. And so then it becomes this sweeping story. You get a little bit of her childhood in Norway. She grew up in Norway. You get the 60s in Chicago. You get his childhood in the 80s in suburban Iowa. And there's just so much in it. So that's the basic plot of this novel. I'd say the writing is really what makes it worth reading. It's like every sentence is just tightly packed. Some of the sentences are like five lines long. It reminds me a lot of Jonathan Franzen or Philip Roth. I think he's better than Jonathan Franzen, which is controversial. But it feels like a Jonathan Franzen novel, but I think it's better because it has more heart. He's good. I mean, there are moments where I was reading this where I called it like head-slapping despair because he just like sums it up. He sums up everything that makes you crazy about the world, and he does such a great job of like hitting the nail on the head, and you're just like, oh, that is what the world is like right now, isn't it? Then on the other hand, he's really hopeful and vulnerable, emotional, and it's really great. It's kind of daunting. The cover is not very attractive, and it's really heavy and big, but if you give it a chance, it's such a good read. I gave it to a friend who was really skeptical, and she ended up reading it in 3 days and loved it. And then it's actually going to be made into, this is very exciting, I just found this out. So Meryl Streep loves this book too, and she is producing and starring in, what was that?
So you should have started with that.
She
like
started
Meryl
with that.
So
Meryl Streep,
like, okay.
Meryl Streep is going to produce and star in a TV adaptation of The Nix. And she's working with J.J. Abrams, who does, he did Lost, he did the Star Wars movie, so those two together are going to be making a TV adaptation of The Nix, which is incredible, and I can't wait. So that's The Nix. Anything else?
Okay, switching gears, I guess. So my first book is The Address by Fiona Davis. Some of you may remember she did The Dollhouse as well, which got rave reviews. This had mixed reviews from Goodreads and from novelists, which surprised me because I actually thought it was a fabulous story. Picture 1884 in New York City, and the Upper West Side is basically farmland. And they're building the Dakota apartment building. So if anyone's been to New York, it's really a story as much about the building of the Dakota as it is about the characters in there. But it does give you a real feel for what New York was like in the late 1800s. It's divided into two parts, so there's a modern day piece to it that is 100 years later. It starts with a young lady who's in London. She's a housekeeper at a very posh London hotel. And Theodore Camden, who's the architect for the Dakotas, is around looking for employees that can staff this new building that's in the process of being built. And he needs somebody who has the experience to take on multiple apartments with lots of different concerns of tenants. And he finds this young lady who's kind of looking for a job and looking for an adventure because she had sort of a misalliance that didn't work out so well. And she ends up coming to America just by herself, lands in New York, and starts working at the Dakota. And she's, I would say, intrigue and passion, and then a murder, are things that happen all at once and without really understanding anything that's going on. And then you find someone is now in an asylum, and she's been transported there against her will, and there's a mystery about what exactly happened, who was really responsible. And then you fast forward 100 years later, and you meet a niece, a grandniece of Theodore Camden, who was the person who was murdered in the Dakota. And now there's a whole discussion about who should inherit the properties that he's acquired. And there's a bit of intrigue about that as well. So it had me very confused, really, because I didn't understand why it was so convoluted. And it doesn't really resolve until the second part of the novel. So I think you have to get through the first half, and then you'll be totally engaged. And the second part makes it worthwhile. So. Interestingly, I love historical fiction because I like to wander around in New York and go look at all of the places that she visited. Her new book, Fiona Davis, is coming out with a masterpiece, and it's going to be published in October. And evidently, there was an art school under Grand Central Terminal, And so it's about two artists 50 years apart who then are trying to make their way in the world and make a name for themselves, and they're up against some great odds. So I haven't read that one yet, but if you like Fiona Davis and you are interested in historical fiction, particularly about New York, I would recommend this as a great summer book, and then maybe vacation somewhere to New York City and wander around the Dakota, which also was where John Lennon was murdered right outside the front doors there. And it's now a co-op, and very, very selective, and you actually have a difficult time getting in, even if you are a celebrity. But I think Lauren Bacall lived there at some time. So, the address by Fiona Davis. The Marsh King's Daughter is probably one of my favorite books that I read in this past year. It came out in 2017, so it's not necessarily brand new, but it's based on a Hans Christian Andersen folktale. So there was an Egyptian woman who was kidnapped by the Marsh King, and she had a baby, and the baby was sent to be brought up by a Viking woman, and this is the Hans Christian Andersen version of the story. And the daughter has a terrible temper and a terrible character, and she turns into a frog at night, a kind and gentle frog. And then at one point she meets a young man who's a slave, and he teaches her about kindness and truth and how people should be nice to one another. And she transforms from this awful, terrible, toadish person to a beautiful swan at the end of that particular story. This particular story doesn't end quite so cleanly or happily ever after. There's a young woman who is at 14 abducted and taken into the marsh by this awful, terrible sociopath. And she has a child. And the child lives in the marsh for 12 years and is brought up by this sociopathic father. And he teaches her to trap and hunt and fish. And he is a master at trapping. And he's a master at manipulation. And at one point, they do finally, the authorities come and take him away. And so she then transforms into a very middle-aged, affluent family with two lovely daughters and a husband who loves her very much. And they have absolutely no idea that her childhood was 12 years sort of being maligned and terribly manipulated by this awful father. And then one day he kills two prison guards and he escapes from prison. And she knows that he's going to come after her because he needs to eradicate his past. And she's terrified for her family and for herself. But she knows that she is the best person to track him, because he taught her everything that she knows. And so you have the terror of footsteps in the night in the cabin, and the chance encounters when someone walks by the window at night and you're not sure who it is, but she has a prickly spider feelings in her back and she knows that she's being watched. And you can't put it down. So once you start, I just want you to know that you will be up all night reading this book. But it's worth every page, so please do. The third choice. This is the serendipity when you go and you do the paging list in the morning sometimes, or I help out with the surf desk, and books kind of just fall out of the shelves onto your hands because you're just standing there and it's like, oh, Mr. Churchill's. And it was a return. It came back. Somebody else had taken it out. It was on the book cart. And I happened to be just shelving that day. And I decided that I was intrigued by the title and the cover. So I don't know. You're not supposed to judge a book by its cover. But the publishers will tell you that that's exactly why they designed it this way. So I have to say, the very first chapter, it's very odd. Because normally authors try to pique your interest and give you characters that, you know, really... You're led into the story and you're really interested in them. Well, four pages into this book, what you thought was the primary character, which was Mr. Churchill's secretary, is killed, murdered. So then you wonder, well, what is this story really about? Well, it's about a young woman who just graduated from Wellesley College, who has a grandmother who has a home in London. And she never met the grandmother. but she's inherited this house, and she's sent over to London to deal with putting the house on the market and selling it. So you find this young lady sitting in London, and all of a sudden, the war breaks out. And so she decides that rather than go home to Wellesley, where she really didn't know what she was going to do, she would see if she could get a job doing something. And she's a great typist. She's also incredibly intrepid and very courageous. And it kind of reminded me of Nancy Drew. It's like an older version of Nancy Drew. So I was a Nancy Drew fan. I read all of them, like back to back. And I just think that Maggie Hope is sort of what I would hope Nancy Drew might have grown up to become. So there's a little bit, you know, there's a lot about the Blitz. So it, again, historical fiction, if you like to have settings that you can really kind of immerse yourself into the history of the time. And there's a little bit of romance, and then there's also a lot of intrigue. But she's plucky, and she's funny, and she creates this great group of friends that are really supportive until they're not. And so it's, she started out, I think that this is by Susan L. McNeil, and she started out with four books. The Maggie Hope series was intended to be a four-book series initially, and it caught on so well that The Paris Spy is the most recent one, and it was just, it's being released as a trade paperback, I think in August. So if you happen to like the character and Maggie kind of breaks your heart a little bit, you can be assured that you'll have seven more of these volumes to keep your interest. I would say it's mostly fictional. I think there's parts of it that do cite Winston Churchill's speeches. They have some of his writings, and supposedly she, you know, enhances some of his talks and speeches with her perspective, and you know that's what makes it brilliant. But she did the Princess Elizabeth's Spy, His Majesty's Hope, the Prime Minister's Secret Agent, and The Queen's Accomplice, Mrs. Roosevelt's Confidant, and then the most recent one, The Paris Spy. So, again, mixed reviews from a lot of novelists and other places, but I thought it was a good quality. My final book, you can't actually get it yet, and I apologize for that. It was supposed to come out this month, but they pushed back the release date to July 24th. And this is a debut novel, and the title is Ghosted, and it's by Rosie Walsh. And a little bit about Rosie. Rosie is a documentary producer who lives in Bristol, England. And I will start with just the very first part of this, the chapter one. Dear you, it's exactly 19 years since that luminous morning when we smiled and said goodbye. That we would see each other again was never in doubt, was it? It was a question of when, not if. In fact, it wasn't even a question. The future might have seemed as insubstantial as the curled edge of a dream, but unequivocally contained us both, together. And yet it didn't. Even after all these years, I find myself stunned by that. And you don't actually understand who he's talking about or who this person who is stunned by all of this 19 years that there's been this absence until the very last chapter. So it takes you the whole book to wrap this one up in a bow and tie it, but it's worth it. So Sarah meets Eddie and they connect instantly. They get along great, they have the same interests, they are having a wonderful time together. They can't have enough of each other's company. And after a week of this, Eddie has to go. He needs to leave because he's committed to a surfing trip in Spain with some of his buddies. And it's been planned for ages. He can't get out of it. It's all been paid for, but he promises he will be back because this connection is so strong and it's so vibrant and there's not a doubt in their mind that absolutely this, you know, a week, what's a week vacation? It happens all the time. Until you're ghosted. And so to be ghosted, does everyone know what ghosted is?
Yes.
No. It's kind of a new, so from Psychology Today, ghosting, for those of you who haven't experienced yet, is having someone that you believe cares about you, whether it be a friend or someone you're dating, disappear from contact without any explanation at all. No phone call, no email, not even a text. Ghosting isn't new. People have been long done disappearing with acts. But years ago, this kind of behavior was certainly considered limited to a certain type of scoundrel. In today's dating culture, being ghosted is a phenomenon that approximately 50% of women and men have experienced. That's shocking. And almost an equal number have done the ghosting. Ghosting gives you no cue for how to react. It creates the ultimate scenario of ambiguity. Should you be worried? What if they're hurt and lying in a hospital bed somewhere? Should you be upset? Maybe they're just a little busy and will be calling you at any moment. You don't really know how to react because you don't know what happened. And that's exactly the scenario in this book. She can see that he's online. Those little bubbles come up when he's messaging, you know, that he's starting to type something on that, you know, messenger, but then it disappears. And it magically never happens to have anybody at the other end of it. And then she calls, he's in a football club, the Gaelic football club, and she calls his friends, and they kind of say, you know, maybe you should just let it go. Just, you know, he doesn't want to get it, just forget him. But she can't. So he's not going to be found, and she's still wondering, where did he go? Why isn't he responding to her? What secrets could he be hiding? And why did he disappear like a ghost? So we have one arc, advanced reader's copy. So whoever gets out there first, we'll keep it there. But fabulous book, and I would put holds on this because it's coming out and it's terrific.
Okay. Well, my book is Bear Town by Frederick Bachman. I love Frederick Bachman. So I wondered how a man who is 37 years old can have such depth in his books. So I went online and did a little digging and found a podcast which I listened to. So I want to share with you what I learned about Frederick Bachman. He's 37 years old, and he was a college dropout when he published his first novel. He was working as a forklift driver at a food warehouse at night and weekends so he could write during the day. And the interviewer asked him how he started writing. And he said, "I was a weird kid. Communicated well with people. So I wrote letters, I wrote notes. I wrote to my father when I was angry with him, and he wrote back. We never actually had a conversation. He said, I still live in the same building as my father, and I still only text and email. So he got a lot of practice here. He said, I also understand that I wasn't special. And that's what something that if he likes it, he knows other people like it. And I think that's part of his appeal also. And he said, a book can break any rules as long as it's alive. So at age 25, he tries to make a living. And he wrote for magazines, free. Then he started a blog. He was getting married at that time, and he started discussing planning his wedding on a blog, and that was very well received. So he finds it's a chore to get the story right. And this part is what I love the most. He said, in order to make a reader cry, the author would have to cry writing it. So he certainly makes me cry, and I think he makes a lot of people cry. You have to feel the things that are difficult. Again, feel. Beartown started out as a screenplay, but he couldn't work with the TV people, so he wrote it as a novel. The central character is a town. It's a story about sports, what it meant to him. He fell in love with sports as a kid. He wanted to write about the darker side of sports, the win or die attitude. And this is the introduction to Beartown. For my grandmother, Saga Bachman, who taught me to love sports, what a quiet life I would have lived without her. I hope that the big bar in heaven serves proper dry martinis and they always show Wimbledon on the big screen. I miss you. See how he feels? It's just wonderful. Now, the book starts out, the first chapter is, late one evening, toward the end of March, a teenager picked up a double-barreled shotgun, walked into the forest, put the gun to someone else's forehead, and pulled the trigger. This is the story of how we get here. Now, how could anyone not continue the book? It's about hockey, it's about a town. And I am only going to plagiarize what someone else wrote because I couldn't do it any better. It says, this book is hard to read and it's impossible to stop. It's about a tiny town losing jobs and losing hope. It's about children and parents and marriage. It's about love and hate and transcendent joy. It will bring you out and lift you up. So I would say if you haven't read Beartown, you should. This is his fifth novel, and actually he's written a sequel to this called Us Against You, I believe, and that is out now. So again, Frederick Bachman is just my name now. The second one I'm going to talk about is White Chrysanthemum. This is a debut model about a Korean family. It's a historical fiction under the, about Korea under the Japanese occupation during World War II. It is about divers, women divers, who are called Enyas. And a female diver is a has more independence than any other Koreans do. They actually, because they are so independent, they will dive and make a lot of money. They'll go down and they will look for abalone and other fish. They only wear a mask and flippers. They don't wear anything else. They are older women for the most part because the younger ones are not doing this anymore. But they actually provided for the family. They were the first working moms in Korea, were the Henya women. And they put their kids through college. They built schools. They had a certain amount of autonomy in their society. And they had the freedom to divorce, which other people didn't so much in Korea. And actually, this little island that they were on, Jeju Island, has the highest divorce rate of anyone in Korea. Because, of course, they can make the money in order to afford to get divorced. Now, there are two sisters in the story. The first one is Hannah, she's 16 years old, and her sister is 9 years old. Hannah is doing diving and has come out of the water when she sees a Japanese soldier walking along the shore smoking a cigarette. Her little 9-year-old sister is sitting not too far from her. The one thing her mother has always stressed upon her is never leave your sister alone. Always watch over your sister. And she has promised she would do this. Well, in order to make sure that her sister is all right, she makes sure that she talks to the Japanese soldier, who is a military man, and he is looking for a sex to be a prostitute for the military. So he takes her away and takes her to Manchuria. But by so doing this, she has saved her sister, which is what she promised that she would do with her mother. So throughout the book, there are two, it's written in 1943, Hanya's story about her life as a sex slave, and then 2011, Emmy, her sister, is writing about her life now that Hanya is gone. The sisters have always maintained a love for each other, even though they are separated. And it is a beautiful story. It's hard to read sometimes, but the love is there and it's wonderful. And it's something that I think is unusual because we know about what's happened in World War II to women in Germany and all of other places, but not in Korea. So I would suggest that this is a good read. You learn something new and it's good historical fiction. And my third one here is Kristen Hannah's The Great Alone. Now, Kristen Hannah is a wonderful author, and most everybody here has probably read her her book,
The Nightingale?
The Nightingale. I'm thinking of the lilac of The Nightingale. So that was a huge seller. I think this will also be a huge bestseller. It takes place in Alaska, and she was in Alaska with her family in the 1980s. Her father decided to take the family in a Volkswagen bus across country to find some place that they really liked. So they found some places they liked, but they lived in Alaska for some years during the 1980s. And during camping trips, her father read poetry by Robert Service to the kids. So the title for her book came from her father, The Great Alone. This is a bit of the poem. Were you ever out in the great alone when the moon was awful clear and the icy mountains hemmed you in with a silence you could hear, with only the howl of a timber wolf, and you camped there in the cold, a half-dead thing in a stark, dead world, clean mad for the muck called gold, while high overhead, green, yellow, and red, the north lights swept in bars. What a wonderful poem. You could almost just visualize that. So the book starts in 1974, and for those of us who were around then, we remember that the world was in a turmoil. The Vietnam War, Watergate, gas shortage, and much more to cause people to be unsettled. Well, this is Alaska, 1974. Unpredictable, unforgiving, untamed. The book is about Ernst Albright, who was a former POW. He comes home from the Vietnam War, a changed and volatile man. He moves his family, a daughter, Lenny, who's 13, and his wife, Cora, to Alaska, to a house that he's inherited from a war buddy who didn't make it home. When he gets there, he finds out it's a very small house. It's full of junk and cobwebs and smells. There's no running water. It's really not what he envisioned. Although, once the house gets fixed up, and there's also obviously no running water, so there's no toilet, so there's something that we used to always call a sweet and sour, an outhouse out there. So, I mean, I didn't have an outhouse. However, it used to go someplace where they had one.
In Alaska.
Anyway, so at first, Alaska seems to be the answer to their prayers. In a remote corner of the state, they find a fiercely independent community of strong men and women who help the Albrights. But as winter approaches and darkness descends on Alaska, Ernst's fragile mental state deteriorates, and the family begins to fracture. Lenny and Cora realize that they are on their own. The Great Alone is a beautiful story about love and loss, the fight for survival, and the wilderness that lives in both man and nature. This is a complex family drama about coming of age and domestic violence, not always an easy read, but one well worth doing. And my last book is The Alternate Side. Now, I think this is the third one about New York. It takes place in New York. Anna Quinlan lives in New York. She also loves New York. So the alternate sides, I like the title. The theme of there being two sides is examined over and over. You could refer to which side of the street to park the car on during cleaning days. Don't forget, this is New York. We're in New York now. It could refer to the haves and the have-nots, the rich and the servants. It could refer to different personalities, different sexes, different opinions. Two sides to a story, examined over and over. It's a story of a long marriage of Nora and Charlie Nolan. They are very comfortable, and they live in a posh neighborhood in Manhattan. Now, I grew up in the country, so I'm not a big, I have no big knowledge of New York, but I can just imagine that parking is a big problem. Actually, this book is about parking spaces and marital strife. And that's really Charlie finds, as the book opens, that he has just been awarded a spot in this parking space. It's about this big, and it's room for six cars. He's waited for a long time, and he finally has gotten a space. So he thinks he has arrived. He's just tickled pink. So there are other people who live in the houses are a lot like them. They're very comfortable. They have servants. They have kids in college. It's very upper class. And it explains a lot about New York. Maybe the first 75 pages talk a lot about New York. Then the thing that happens here is racial tensions well over when a rich white lawyer hits a Latino handyman with a golf club for blocking a parking lot entrance. And then suddenly there's bitterness and resentment among neighbors, among spouses. Nora concludes there are only three kinds of marriages: happy, miserable, and acceptably unhappy. The novel has an exceptional depiction of complex characters and the intricacies of close relationships. I found it to be an enjoyable, entertaining, and easy read that made me laugh, think, and actually reflect. I enjoyed it, and I enjoyed learning a lot about New York, so I would recommend it as a good book read that makes you think.
So, that concludes our third Book Buzz panel. I want to thank all of you guys for coming in and listening. And please feel free to help yourself to refreshments. Friends are the program supporters of this, so thanks to the Friends of the Library always for all of their support of all of our programs. And I hope everyone will take out a couple of titles that have been discussed, and happy reading. Thank you.